How are you? You're just about to start the class. I was facing some connectivity issue here. So I'm just sending the message to the other students so that they can also join in the class. Just one second. Yeah, I was facing a technical issue, but now we can start the class. Should I start it with you being all alone over here and let other students join in because we are already late for the class? Okay. So today that the last area of capital budgeting that I want to discuss with you is the risk management area in capital budgeting. Basically, in capital budgeting we discussed about that it is an investment decision. And we discussed about various techniques of capital budgeting. We discussed about the NPV method. We discussed about IRR method. We discussed about the profitability index method. We also discussed about the payback period method. Now today, and while doing all these methods, what we did, we estimated the cash flows, right? While following all these methods, we were estimating the cash flows. So when we are estimating something, don't you think that we are taking a kind of a risk? Because we are taking a call on future, right? And the future is unforeseen. So this capital budgeting decision that we are going to take, because it is going to give its fruits, because it is going to give its results in future, and the future is not very sure, so therefore these capital budgeting decisions are necessarily very risky decisions, isn't it? Whatever we are contemplating, whatever cash flows we are expecting, if we are able to get it, then the capital budgeting decision would be correct. But if we do not get the cash flows, then because there can be any risk, and the longer the period of the project, the more the risk, isn't it? Because we are estimating that this would be the cost, we are estimating this would be the revenue, but it may or may not hold true in future, right? So therefore, we need to understand these capital budgeting decisions from the perspective of risk management, isn't it? It becomes very, very important that we look at it from the perspective of risk and then estimate what kind of risk can be there in this capital budgeting decision. So it has been, for some time a favorite question of the examiner that risk and uncertainty is a part of capital budgeting decision, or what are the risks and uncertainties in the capital budgeting decision. So if this kind of a question comes in examination, you simply have to mention that because in the capital budgeting we are estimating cash flows with respect to futures and with respect to future, and the future costs, future revenues, future profits are very uncertain, so they which cannot be foreseen in the current time. So therefore, definitely the capital budgeting decisions necessarily carry some part of risk, right? So now, how do we evaluate this risk? If there is risk, that does not mean that we are not going to go ahead. Because we have studied in finance, higher the risk, higher the return. But at the same time, we have also been taught various techniques of risk evaluation and various techniques of risk management. So let us first try to find out as to what is the level of risk in a particular capital budgeting decision. Now before I go to that, let me just give you what is risk all about. What is this risk? In the last class I discussed with you the concept of standard deviation and mean. I hope the concept was clear in the last class. I discussed with you about standard deviation and mean. Was the concept clear to you? Okay. So now, when we talk about capital budgeting decisions, we are expecting some returns. So we can say that this expected returns is equals to the mean. Right? This is the average that we expect. That okay, in the given market conditions, this is the average that industry is giving as a return. So we take an average return. Right? Now, if there is a standard deviation, as I discussed with you in the last class, I told you about the number of students in the class and we had taken the height of the students and we tried to find out that how much is the deviation. We also talked to you about two countries where in one country the income levels were 10 and 90, another it was 50 and 60, I believe, 40 and 60, something like that. So we tried to find out the deviation. So the higher the deviation, the higher the risk. Now let me place these figures in a capital budgeting decision. Let us assume that in a capital budgeting decision, let us assume that In one project, we are expecting cash flows which are in the range of say 50 to 60 rupees. And in another project, we are expecting cash flows in the range of 10 to say 95. Now definitely the project which has got a range of 10 to 95 is more risky, isn't it? So if, as we use the concept of standard deviation in statistics, similarly, we can use the concept of standard deviation in capital budgeting also to understand the level of risk. What is risk? Risk is deviation from the expected returns. What is risk? Risk is deviation from the expected return. I welcome Sindhura and Dipali to the class. I just was discussing about the risk in the capital budgeting decision and we've just started because there was a very poor connectivity at my end. So we were talking about the risk. We were saying that because in capital budgeting decisions, what we do, we estimate the future cash flows and then we discount it to the present value. Now, whatever we are estimating for future, it may or may not come true. Right? It may or may not come true. So if there are any chances that whatever we are expecting will not come true, that means the decision has got some element of risk, isn't it? So how do we measure this risk? That was the question that I was trying to answer. Because this is something which is very important. So because we have been told higher the risk, higher the return that we should expect. So in a particular capital budgeting decision where the level of risk is going to be higher, we should expect a higher return, isn't it? So the one of the measures of risk is standard deviation. We've discussed this technique in the last class. We said that standard deviation is a statistical technique used in capital budgeting decisions to determine the variation or deviation from the mean of cash flows of the project. That means that, okay, we were expecting a particular level of cash flows. So if the cash flows can deviate from that particular level, that is the standard deviation. The project with lesser standard deviation in cash flows carries lesser risk and uncertainty. Lower the standard deviation, the better it is for the project, right? And how do we measure standard deviation? We have said that standard deviation is measured as x, as if we have got the probability, then we write probability multiplied by x minus x bar square, and we take a square root of that to find out standard deviation. Probability multiplied by x minus x bar square is equals to variance, and the square root of variance is standard deviation. Now, when we talk about standard deviation, as I discussed with you in the last class, where we found that in one project the standard deviation was 45, another project it was 10, right? Now, we said that the project which has got 45 standard deviation is more risky. But then, you know, giving this a kind of a decision would not be correct because we need to find the standard deviation as a percentage of mean. Because otherwise, comparing two different projects would be, you know, we would not be able to rank them. So the technique where we try to find out the percentage of standard deviation to mean is called coefficient of variation. Because if we have to compare alternative projects and we want to compare the uncertainty in two alternative projects, if they are different in size, then what we need an information on the coefficient of variation, which is a percentage of standard deviation to mean. Right? So one, we found standard deviation. The second, we rated the different projects with respect to the risk levels by finding out the coefficient of variation. Fine with us? Is the two methods clear? Two techniques, are they clear to everybody? The coefficient again. See, I'm saying that in the last class I told you, when we tried to calculate standard deviation, in the first case the standard deviation was coming as 45, and in the second case it was coming as 10, right? In the first case the mean was 50, and in the second case also the mean was 50. So if we are able to find out the percentage of standard deviation to mean, we can say that it is 90% standard deviation in case of in A case, and it is 10% it is 20% standard deviation in B case, right? So if we are able to find out percentages, we would be able to say, because in, right now the two projects are having the same level of mean, but it may happen that in one case the mean is say 60 or maybe 90, and in the second case the mean may be maybe 30. So in that situation, you know, the ranking of the projects might get difficult. So in order to find out the ranking, what we should do, we should write standard deviation divided by mean multiplied by 100. It's just to find out the percentage of standard deviation vis-a-vis the mean, right? So the third is the risk adjusted discount rates. Now what do I mean to say by that? See, risk adjusted discount rates means that supposing we are contemplating a higher level of risk in a particular project, right? Because it has got a higher standard deviation or it has got a higher coefficient of variation. So what we should do, we should discount that particular project's cash flows at a higher rate of return, right? When we do the discounting, what we should do, we should discount the cash flows of a project which is safer with a lower rate of discounting, and we should discount the cash flows of the project which is riskier with a higher rate of discounting. So that way we would be able to get a lower net present value for a project which is more risky and a higher net present value for a project which is less risky, and thereby, you know, we would be able to put the two projects together and then compare which gives you a higher net present value. Another is the certainty equivalent approach. In this particular approach, they divide the cash flows into two parts. Because if we are expecting that, okay, this particular project is going to give me a cash flows of rupees 10,000 per month or per year, in that situation, we can divide this into two parts. We can say that, okay, 5,000 is risk-free. Now, 5,000 is certain, and 5,000 may or may not come. Getting a return of 5,000 is certain, and the remaining 5,000 may or may not come. So in that situation, you will have to divide the cash flows into two parts. The risk. So then you have to discount the riskless cash flows at a risk-free rate and the risky cash flows at a risky rate, right? And that is how you can find out the certainty equivalent approach. So you can say that, okay, out of the total cash flows, what is the proportion of riskless cash flows to the risky cash flows? What is the proportion? So higher the certainty equivalent, the better it is for a particular project. Higher the certainty equivalent, the better it is for the project, because that is for sure that this much percentage we are going to receive for sure, and the remaining may or may not come. I would be giving you some of the examples of these techniques also. So if in the beginning you're finding it a little too theoretical, don't worry about that. I'm giving you theory and then I would be moving to some practical questions also here. The next is a decision tree technique. Now in the decision tree technique, what we try to understand is that, okay, if we take a capital budgeting decision, there can be maybe two alternatives. One is we go ahead with the project. Second is we do not go ahead with the project. Now if we decide to go ahead with the project, in that situation, the project may give this much of cash flow, or it may give lesser, or it may not give any cash flows, right? So we have got various variants coming from a particular decision. If it gives the cash flow, then we would be reinvesting that cash flow in business. So again, we can talk about some return on those cash flows as well. So that is called a decision tree technique, and we would be doing a practical question on this as well. The next is a sensitivity analysis, which I did with you, which I discussed with you in the last class, where we had tried to find out the net present value, and then we tried to understand that if the selling price increases by, if the selling price decreases by 5%, what is going to be the impact on net present value, or if the cost price increases by 10%, what is going to be the impact on the net present value. I hope you remember that particular question. So there I discussed with you. So here what we try to understand, the variables where there can be some kind of a variability. You know, there can be some variables which may change, and then we have to understand the possibility of change in these variables, and then try and find out the impact of change in these variables on the net present value of the project. Right, and this we can do it with different variables, and we can do some variables at one go as well. And then we have to compare the original rate of return with the degree of sensitivity that we did. We said, you know, 70, there's going to be an impact to an extent of 76% on the cash flows, where we try to understand the degree of sensitivity. I hope you remember that if the selling price changes by 10%, the net present value gets reduced by 76%. Right, so that is how we had done in the last class, and based upon the sensitivity analysis, then you can do a subjective evaluation of whether you want to actually go ahead with the project or not. The next technique for risk evaluation is simulation technique. In simulation, which I would be doing with the help of a particular example, a simple example with you, here we try to construct a mathematical model and try to, you know, to make a what-if analysis, assuming that we are not able to identify the variables which may change. But future is uncertain, and we want to check as to if certain things change, what will happen? What will happen? So in order to do that, we have to do simulation, which I would be discussing with you. And the last is linear programming. Linear programming is also called a constraint analysis, where we mention the constraints. This is most helpful in capital rationing, where we try to, you know, put in the constraints that, okay, this is my limited budget and these are my constraints. And in the given, I try to formulate an objective function where I try to maximize my net present value within the given constraints, and try to solve the problem with the help of linear programming technique. So in the June examination, because as I said, this has over a period of time started becoming a favorite topic of the examiner. So, there was a question in the examination in June 15, explain the concept of sensitivity analysis. What is sensitivity analysis? Explain that. Right. So, you have to mention that in sensitivity analysis, we have to find out the various variables and try to find out how sensitive they are. How sensitive is the change in these variables on the net present value. Right. So it gives, because it will give the management a better information about the possible outcomes that can occur. And in that, if we know that what could be the possible outcomes, then we can use our judgment and experience to accept or reject a particular project. Right. So here we try to place certain assumptions and try to see that if the assumptions change, then what is going to be the impact on the investment. Right. So therefore, sensitivity analysis helps a lot, and you can do sensitivity analysis on a computer as well, and it helps you in estimating the returns, by changing the various variables, and then you can find out that whether the project should be acceptable or not. So before we go further, let me do 2-3 review questions with you, whether a question from this part are of theory or more of practical. Well, up to one year back, the questions coming from this part were purely theoretical in nature. But from the last 1 year, we have seen that at times they're asking questions, which are practical also. So I'll be doing some of the practical questions with you so that you have a fair idea as to how do we use these techniques. They're not very difficult, just have some patience and we would be able to understand them. The question is, Surya Manufacturers is planning to start a new manufacturing process. I'll be just giving you the concept of standard deviation and coefficient of variation over here, right? So Surya Manufacturer is planning to start a new manufacturing process. Following are the estimated net cash flows and probabilities of the new manufacturing process. They are planning a new manufacturing process, and if they start with this new manufacturing process, they will have to invest rupees 2 lakhs, which is your cash outflow at year zero, right? Now, there are 20% chances that in the next 5 years, the cash inflows would be 40,000 rupees per annum. There are 60% chances that the cash inflows would be 60,000 rupees per annum. And if this will happen, then you will also have a salvage value of rupees 40,000. And there are again 20% chances that the cash flows would be rupees 80,000 per annum. And if that would happen, you can also get a salvage value of rupees 60,000. Right? Surya Manufacturers' cost of capital for an average risk project is 10%. So the situation is clear. We are deciding to invest rupees 2 lakhs. This 2 lakhs can give you 40,000 or 60,000 or 80,000, any returns. The probability of these three returns is 20%, 60% and 20% respectively. That completely depends upon the market conditions, right? So the situation is clear. Is the situation clear to everybody? Okay. So now we go to the questions. We have to find out the best case and the worst case here. So what we should do whenever we have been given a question of this kind, as we did in the last class. So what we did was we multiplied the cash flows with the probabilities to find out the expected cash flows. Right? We multiplied the cash flows with probabilities to find out the expected cash flow. So in year 0, 2 lakhs multiplied by 20% was 40,000 rupees. In year 0, for 60% probability, 2 lakhs was multiplied with 60%. And for the third situation, the same 2 lakh was multiplied with 20%. So then we added the three together. So in year 0, whatever be the probabilities, the amount which has to be invested is rupees 2 lakhs. Now year 1, we have been told that there are 20% chances that you can get 40% return. Then there are 60% chances that you can get 60,000 return. And then there are 20% chances that you can get 80,000 return. So we have multiplied the probabilities with the cash flows and then added the three together. So we realize that in the 5 years, the expected cash flow is coming as 60,000 rupees. We've also been told that in case of 60%, there's 60% probability that you would be getting a salvage value of rupees 40,000, and there is 20% chance that you can get a salvage value of rupees 60,000. So we multiplied the salvage value also with the probabilities. So the salvage value which is expected is 36,000 rupees. Now we've got the expected cash flows. What we should do, we should discount them to the present value to find out the net present value, right? So what we did, we mentioned the cash flows over here, and because this was at year zero, so there's no need for any discounting. In year one, we divided it with 1.1 because 10% is a discounting rate. In year two, we divided it with 1.1 raised to power 2, and so on and so forth. So having discounted all of them for 5 years, we have then reduced the cash outflows from the total of cash inflows, and we found that the net present value is coming as 49,800 rupees. Now because the net present value is positive, so we would decide to go ahead with the project as a base case scenario. Like on an average, we should go ahead with the project. Now, we have been told that we have to find out the NPV of the worst case and the NPV of the best case as well. So in order to find out NPV of worst case, what we will do, the worst case scenario is 40,000 rupees per annum. initial investment is rupees 2 lakhs and no no salvage value, right? So we simply discount it at 10% and find out that if the worst case is going to be there, then there's going to be a negative net present value of 48,369, right? So in the worst situation, there's going to be a loss in the net present value of 48,369. And if I take the worst, if I take the base case scenario, then in that situation, we're going to get 60,000 rupees.